Bonjour, je suis Patrick Tambay et vous êtes à l'écoute de Beyond the Grid.
Hi everyone, Tom Clarkson here and welcome to Beyond the Grid, presented by Bose Quiet Comfort 35-2 wireless headphones. My guest this week is a man who raced for some of Formula One's top teams, including McLaren, Ferrari and Renault. He won a couple of races for Ferrari, but it was the way in which he carried the team through the second half of 1982, which was one of the most tumultuous seasons in its history, that left as big an impression as any trophy, especially for the Tifosi. I'm talking, of course, about Patrick Tambay. Patrick is one of motorsport's good guys. He arrived in F1 via the circuitous route of downhill skiing, the US college system, and the American Can-Am series. He was very highly rated, to the extent that he had the choice of Ferrari or McLaren in his first full season in 1978. He chose McLaren, and his close friend Gilles Villeneuve went to Ferrari. Patrick would, of course, eventually join the Prancing Horse in 82, when he was called upon to take none other than Villeneuve's seat after the Canadian's tragic death. He then had to carry the team forward when Ferrari's other driver, Didier Pironi, suffered horrendous injuries during practice at Hockenheim. It was a dangerous time, a time for warriors. And Patrick remains one to this day as he bravely battles Parkinson's disease. We caught up recently in his homeland, at Paul Ricard, in fact, where Patrick gamely regaled me with stories from his fascinating career. His illness means his voice is weaker today than it once was, but it certainly wasn't going to stop him chatting. To kick things off, I asked him how he got his start in this crazy world we call motorsport. But how much racing was there in your family?
None.
None at all?
None.
So how
My
did
mother
you...
didn't want me to do any motor racing, mountain climbing and motorcycle. Those were the three forbidden things that I should play with.
So what drew you to car racing?
An accident.
It was an accident?
An accident. I just happened to be in Monaco when they rolled out the new Formula Renault for 72. And I said, you can drive this car? Yeah, it's here for promotion for you to see. We're going to be able to run you if you want at Paul Ricard. And I was happy to go down to Paul Ricard because it's closer to home, to Cannes. And I didn't expect to be a racing driver. I didn't want to. And I thought that I couldn't make it. I looked at the pictures of Sport Auto, of magazines, and that's all. I got excited by that.
So was it a lightning bolt moment for you? The
moment
you drove the car, it was like, I've discovered something.
Lightning? No, I'm going to use another word. It was a climax.
It was that
every day. Yes.
It was that
I can remember down there, that hangar, getting into the car, starting the engine, and Ardon.
You know what kind of podcast this is, Patrick, but it really was that exciting for you. You just knew immediately this is what you wanted to do.
No, I didn't know what that it was something for me to do. I just reacted to it physically and emotionally. I was taken by the excitement of the instant.
I suppose, in a way, you had racing in your blood because you'd been part of the French national ski team.
Yeah.
And was that downhill?
Downhill and slalom. At the time, we had to do all of the three discipline.
So you're suitably mad enough to be a racing driver. You knew that.
No, I didn't know if I was mad enough. I just wanted to ski. I just happened to ski also very close to where we live in Cannes. It takes an hour to go up in the mountains and being capable of finding downhill FIA piste.
How good were you at skiing?
Not good enough to become Killy or Peria. Jean-Claude Killy is a great, great, great skier. He's also a great driver, but he can only concentrate for 2 minutes and 50 seconds, which is a lap of Targa Florio, for example, which he did.
He won the Targa Florio,
yeah,
didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
Was Killy a friend of yours?
Yes. But he was older. He was one of the older guys.
Yeah. So there was no racing background. It was very much skiing for you.
Yes.
You then tested that Formula Renault in here at Paul Ricard in 1971. You enjoyed it immediately. How quick were you when you first started driving?
I don't know how quick I was. I was quick enough to win the final of the 2 times 10 laps standing start. I had come back from the States where I was a student at the time. So they said, you have still a good lap time on the storyboard of the drivers that have come to the school. You must come back for the finals. So I did come back. And I blew them into the weeds because I had a lot of training.
That's interesting in itself, that you went to university in Colorado. What's wrong with Paris? What's wrong with Nice? What's wrong with...
You're going to have to buy my book and learn some French. I've done a book.
Why Colorado for you?
Well, I fell in love with an American girl. And that happened. That is a story that comes in the book. So you'll have to wait. But it's basically because I felt the American way of life was great. And the American way of life liked me also. So we decided to go.
And I suppose that had a positive effect as well. on your English?
Yes. I've lost my English. I'm sorry. Lost most of my English. This is due to the Parkinson and... The fact that you also a little bit Alzheimer, so it's like they've taken some.
Well, trust me, it's much better than mine.
No, no.
But it must have helped you, that English.
Yes,
when you came in touch with all the British teams.
Yes, absolutely. Everything was, I don't know for what reason, but I know that everything that had happened to me from then on was for a reason, for me being a racing driver.
Did you get exposed to American car racing when you were at university over there?
No.
No, okay.
No. In Boulder University, they didn't have any racetracks. They have one now, I think. And not racing in the States either.
You won the Can-Am Championship twice, once in 1977 and again in 1980. Was part of the reason you raced over there your love of America and love of American life, or was it money? No,
you're right. Just the opening up, the little instant of decision-making to go back to the States to race. Well, it was the first time in 77, it was to build up my experience in Formula One. I started the same time, mid-season, in Formula One and in Can-Am. And it was the reason was to build up enough purse money to be able to pay Teddy Yip for my step into Formula One.
With Theodore.
With Theodore.
Yeah.
And Sid Taylor, and that was $80,000.
Crikey, back then that was, well, even now, that's a fortune, but back then it was twice, 3 times what it did.
Yeah. Compared to what it is now.
Yeah.
I don't know the kids that do it. Mm. The kids is gone.
And the prize money was that good in Can-Am?
I don't know if $80,000 was good, but I had 6 victories.
Yeah.
So it's not much per victory. But every dollar counted for Teddy Yip.
Of course, so you make your Formula One debut in 77, as you say, and that is... When, at least from a Formula One perspective, your career started to cross with Gilles Villeneuve, because you both made your debut together at Silverstone. Do you remember?
It goes further back. Our first encounter. I came to Three Rivers, and he was put out by a color sponsorship to be able to race against a European. Ochoo's coming to be Ochoo, and we got face-to-face confrontation starting in 76 in 77 in Can-Am.
What were your first impressions of Villeneuve?
He was a good racing driver. He didn't have the proper equipment. I was going to blow him up, which I did. But that was before.
Was he a nice man?
Very nice.
Immediately, you had a good relationship.
Yes, immediately with him, with his family, with the kids, with Joanne. It was an immediate bond. But he was doing the crazy things. I was just following.
What kind of stuff was he doing?
Oh, no, I could tell you stuff, but I won't. Like going out with the boat and almost flipping it over.
With you in it?
It's a bad boat, yeah. He just got it and he wanted me to show. And we went outside at Monaco into the high seas, and it was really, 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 really rough. And he almost flipped it. I came down and broke the windshield with the weight of my body and the shock.
What was his reaction to something like that?
Laugh.
He
laughed. Big laugh.
I don't suppose you were laughing. No.
Helicopter. I think the helicopter was the worst. Overloading the helicopter in the mountains in Palu, where he was staying for skiing. Overloading with the Christmas presents, grandparents, father, mother, Jack, and Melanie, and going down the hill to try to get some speed to be able to hoover up. And at the end, it was almost not reachable. The speed was not enough, but he still managed to go down in the big hole, get some speed, and came back up. He should have been...
He tobogganed a helicopter down a hill.
Yeah, he was the owner.
Is that
of the chopper.
Oh, God.
No, crazy stuff.
Crazy stuff. But, well, it's an interesting thing, because after doing your half season in 77, you then... have an opportunity to go to Ferrari for 78, but you opt for McLaren. Why did you make that choice?
I didn't have any manager. I stopped by Charles Stewart in London, where was the base of Philip Morris Racing at the time, managed by John Hogan. And John Hogan told me suddenly, there's a friend of yours coming. Teddy Mayer comes in with his American briefcase, his American watch, and his American way of saying stuff. And
you knew all about that because of your experience in Colorado.
Yes. And I don't know, it sounded more strong than the contract with Ferrari, which had been put out. The meeting with Enzo had been postponed. So I thought... I better hold on to that a couple of years. He said James Hunt would be a better teammate than Carlos Reutemann. The Goodyear tires were going to be better than Michelin tires. They came up with all sorts of good points, good excuses, and I said, okay, I'll go with you.
Did you decide on the spot that you would go in?
Yes, I thought. I mean, I was coming from what? The ensign... at Chamonix in Hockenheim, which was like Chamonix in some way. The Ensign car was a good little team, but we had to borrow gearbox from the bigger team in order to have a straight line speed adequate to the gearbox. And we had to take it out after the race back to McLaren, in fact, because obviously the Ensign guys told me to go to Monaghan and to get Teddy Mayer. I think Teddy Mayer was already the chief. He's a lawyer, was a lawyer, and he had a special way of winding his watch.
Shaking his wrist. So in that 78 season, what did you learn of James Hunt?
I don't think I can tell you all the things I learned.
Okay, how quick was James in 78?
Very quick. I tried to match his speed.
Mm. Because people say who were there at the time, sadly I wasn't, but that 77 was James's best season, a lot of people think. And you think he was carrying that momentum into 78 as well? Mm.
Yes, that's what we all thought. It would happen. But I think at the time, didn't have a car, new car every year. We were split on the seasons. And I don't think that the M26 that he had to drive like I had was a good enough car to be able to bring him to another championship, which it was true. Mm. And afterwards came the Michelins, and that was even stronger. But at the time, I was with John Watson driving an M28, which was the first of the McLaren's carbon fiber chassis, and that broke our momentum a little bit.
And Patrick, what did you learn from James Hunt off the track?
Nothing that I could use again.
Young, good-looking Frenchman.
Nothing that I could use again. I just learned that there was good fun to have around the racetracks, especially when you go from Argentina to Brazil or Brazil to Argentina for 2 weeks in a row there. The McLaren mechanics, learned that why I destroyed three McLarens, one on the Friday, one on Saturday, one on Sunday, and they couldn't fix why this was happening to me, because I had been a pretty reliable driver before. And I told them lately, because now I think there is a lot of water under the bridge, like I said, we say it. And the Brazilian lady that I had met at the time, I would have liked to have a reunion with her and compare our notes now. That's what James taught me, really. And Patrick McNally, also from Philip Morris, which was James' teammate.
So now let's fast forward. So 1979 was a difficult year. John Watson was your teammate. The car wasn't competitive. Why didn't you have an F1 seat in 1980?
Because I didn't want to get back into this carousel. I'd gone to the point where I said, I'm coming back only if I drive for Ferrari or Renault. There was no way that Ferrari or Renault would pick me up after three attempts or whatever. And they did, because of bad circumstances.
So you'd had enough of Formula One after 2 years. What aspect of Formula One?
Basically the equipment. Mm. I'd been good in F2, good compared to teammates like James Hunt in 78. And then suddenly it was shit.
So you'd rather win races in Can-Am than finish 10th in Formula One?
I called Carl Haas and I said this. He kind of understood that I was calling for help, and he said, come over. And I got back there and it started all over again.
So what was the lure of 1981, you know, and being, you know, in the Ligier, the Theodore? Why were you so convinced they were going to be better?
I was looking around for something to happen. I was looking for a match, which didn't happen, did not happen with Ligier. I know now why, but the first race was at French Grand Prix in Manicourt. We had transmission problems. Guy Ligier was a case in itself. And
what do you mean?
More Courvoisier or drinks, hard liquor drinks on the briefing table than there was engineers' paperwork, like I assume today they have. And I almost lost my two legs in Las Vegas by breaking the car in two.
Yeah.
So I came out of the car forward without having to use the safety belt. I mean, it was a big shunt, no dash, no gear lever, no information anymore, and I just hopped.
Any damage at all to you?
No. Just the calves. Should have had like the Danny Young guys, if you've seen that picture
Indianapolis 500.
You can see the car is flying and he's got his two legs out.
That's what it was like for you, but you just luckily...
I didn't have a scratch.
Yeah.
So it was a miracle.
And of course you had another good crash at Monaco in the Haas Lola, didn't you, in 86? I think, was it Mirabeau you had a...
Lismore, Monza.
It was in Monza. Well, I think you had one in Monaco as well.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Monaco. Did you have one in Monza as well?
Yeah, Monza. Monza was not my fault.
Yeah.
Monaco was. I went on to bundle with the new Lola Ford. I was using the Ford engine for the first time. I was six. And I tried to get that point.
Yeah. Well, while we're talking about that Haas Lola, why didn't that work? Because you had a good budget, you had a car that had a bit of a dream team involved. There was Ross Brawn, Adrian Newey, Neil Oatley, who's currently at McLaren. On paper,
Taylor Alexander.
On paper, it looked amazing. Why didn't it work?
It was a whole gang of guys from McLaren's, I think. Teddy Mayer also was involved in being the orchestra. So it was a big band. It didn't work out because the engines were the Ford engines and the era of the turbo. And I think they were the last ones to come in, on board, and they didn't master the problem well enough. So...
Not enough power, or was it unreliability? Or both?
Remember the time in Formula One with the turbo engines, you had to have a lot of smooth pickup and power had to come soon and linear, and we couldn't, it was too violent.
Difficult to control.
Yes.
With your right foot. And was there unreliability as well?
Yes, but because we were struggling with the steering of the engine. So it was...
How good was the car, though? Because that was one of Adrian Newey's sort of early involvement.
Very good.
How good?
Well, I mean, it depends on the speed you're getting to the corner, obviously.
Sure.
But we got to Le Rouge, first lap, very stable. I'm driving a Formula 3. Second lap, flat, and they're on flat all the time. Are you going to say, well, you were getting to the corner slowly? Maybe a little bit slower than the regular guys. But no, the car felt... You felt that you were driving a real racing car.
Can you remember what it was like working with someone like Adrian Newey or Ross Brawn?
Yes.
Because they were young guys back then, just starting.
They were a dream team. I think this is it all. And it's been good because we kept having a good relationship after that on the human part of the game. And that was really nice, especially going to Goodwood and me and seeing them again.
How about Alan Jones, your teammate that year?
AJ. AJ is a good guy. When you're his teammate, if you're not... He's a monster. He's a killer. But he was already a little bit on the downhill side, put on a little bit too much weight, like me today. So, hey, John Z, I hope you follow the diet, but I'm sure you're not.
We spoke to Jonesy earlier in the year for the podcast. His language hasn't improved, let me tell you that. We'll hear more from Patrick in a moment. But first this. If you're the kind of person who never stops asking questions about the world around you, then The Economist might be exactly what you need to feed your curiosity in a time when hard facts and real stories are more important than ever. And if you haven't picked up a copy before, then you might not realize that it's about so much more than just economics and finance. There's something for everyone to explore. A quick flick through its pages, and you'll find articles that cover a range of subjects from world politics and business to science, technology, arts, the environment, and even sport. And one of my favorite articles in recent weeks was about the Cricket World Cup, which is in full swing in the UK. The piece by MJ explained beautifully why England, and I am English, has its best ever chance of winning its first World Cup, to the extent that I'm going to predict here and now that the team will be in the final on the 14th of July. Anyway, The Economist. It's the smart guide to the forces changing your world and has been a trusted source of intelligence for more than 170 years. So if you've never stopped asking questions, then get your hands on a free print copy of The Economist now. Just text GRID, G-R-I-D, to 78070. Text GRID to 78070 to get your free print copy. Now let's get back to Monsieur Tambay. Let's talk about Ferrari. You're so inextricably linked to Ferrari. Can you just talk us through the moment when you heard that Gilles Villeneuve had been killed in Zolder? Where were you?
I was in Hawaii. I was in my father-in-law's den, and the phone rings. It's 10 in the morning over there, 10 in the evening Europe side, and it's Didier Pironi that calls me. And it's something that we all knew would happen one way or the other, off in the helicopter, or on a boat, or in his Bronco, or in his Formula One car. Every time, that would be the limit. Every time he had to push the envelope and test it a little bit further. And sometimes with his car, with his family on board. I remember going to a rally once with a Fiat 121, I think. His daughter lying on the back, sleeping. Jacques holding on to the two and the rest there is, and saying, "Faster, daddy, faster, daddy." And jumping from one corner to the next. Like crazy. He was playing with his kids also. And no surprise that Jack has become a crazy nutter also.
But Patrick, so you're in Hawaii, in your father-in-law's house, and you hear Didier Pironi's voice on the end of the telephone. Mm-hmm. Did you know immediately what he was ringing about? Did you have a gut feeling? I mean, how much contact did you have with Pironi? Was he...
No.
So it was first unusual. Unusual for him to call you.
First time. But he called me to announce that Gilles had had a bad accident. He didn't tell me that he was calling me for to take over his place. He didn't say that was the purpose, and I didn't really compute that it was going to be the case, really. And I think that the telephone started ringing from Europe, and I was calling Europe, and Europe was calling. The time difference, they were staying up a lot. And I was talking with John Lane, Gaston Parent, friends of deep friends of Gilles, to find out what the situation would be with them, with Ferrari, first of all, because I didn't know what we had left under the special terms and strange terms, and Jill had picked up the role of number one driver in there, and I didn't know what it was going to be, but it was going to be all good.
When you reflect on what we're talking about now, 35 years on, does it still feel terribly emotional?
Yes. Because I think everybody felt it. Everybody felt the situation. And they were all helping to forget all that bad things, concentrate on the good things. Now it's easy to say, but at the time it was a lot of pressure, especially in Hockenheim, And I think we're in Imola when it's...
Let's talk about then how it came to be that you would replace Gilles in the team. How soon afterwards did you get a call from someone at Maranello inviting you?
The next day.
Right, okay.
Because Pironi has had the feeling that it was okay. The Ferrari felt that they couldn't say no. I could have, but not knowing that what I know now, it's...
What was it like to replace your friend?
You don't replace anyone. Your friend or mate or adversary. It's not a replacement. You're taking a place over, but it's not, you don't replace it. Mm-hmm. Replace it. Mm-hmm. You probably are more motivated than if you're just doing it for you. They had the impression that I was doing it for us, and he was part of the adventure. I was finishing up his job. That's why maybe that made me stronger, because I was doing it for someone that cared, that I cared for. You understand?
Mm-hmm. How good was that car?
It was not too good initially. That's why he probably had that accident. It got better and better and better and better when they tried to stiffen it. Harvey Postlewaite had done a great way to work with it. It was carbon fiber and honeycomb. And they started to try to make it stiffer, sturdier on the back end, not to be flexing too much with all the big power that we had. The car had to not be flexing. And the gearbox was just a piece of beautiful machinery like Ferrari would expect you to have. It was a transversal gearbox. I could just play with it with two fingers. And I just, when I went to Renault the following 84, it was a truck gearbox, shit gearbox. We worked on it with Tommaso Carletti, which was my engineer at Ferrari, and he had come with me at Renault.
Okay.
And he tried to improve the bloody gearbox, but never succeeded. Should have worked on the fuel consumption.
How did you find Enzo Ferrari to deal with? Can you speak Italian?
I could a little bit at the time. I just picked up every day a word. It was better and better as we went along. But I can't hold the conversation. I could not.
Was he a straightforward guy?
Yes. I always have felt very good with him. I've never been putting myself on the wrong side of the stick. And therefore, he didn't have anything to brag about me. So I think he was surprised also with what I produced. Now, in fact, he did, because I learned afterwards that he was very impressed, or he cried on the TV. He was an old man, but he cried watching the end of the race. I think it was in Hockenheim, or was it Imola? I don't know, but he cried. It's Harvey Postlewaite, which was an engineer at the factory, that reports that. He was, for me, was fair.
Just two other things I wanted to ask you about Ferrari. One was Hockenheim, 82. Your first win with Ferrari, the first Grand Prix win of your career.
I should not have been scheduled to win it. I think Didier Pironi was scheduled to win it. He has had a big misunderstanding with Alain Prost. He flew up, landed on the nose with his legs in the front. At the time, today would be a joke, no problem. But then we lost so many guys like that. So his legs were cut into the brackets in the front, and he had to be severely taken care of by Professor Sayan in Paris. And that was a bad time also for us.
So that accident took place during practice at Hockenheim, wasn't it? And it was raining and the conditions were horrible. How difficult was it for you to lift the team, keep going, and win that race?
Not difficult at all. If I can brag about doing it like that way. We were fighting against the Brabhams that were on a one stop. We had to start with a full tank. So initially we were slow, but then we had to go fast in the second part of the race, which is what I did. And everything went natural, because I had not been a number one. And nobody considered that I was a number one. And it turned out that I did score enough points to be able to be halfway through the years if we take the points.
Oh, exactly. You scored more world championship points from halfway yes. through 82 to halfway through 83. If it had been like the WEC super season, you would have been world champion.
Yeah, yes. Know?
Yeah.
Yes. And Rosberg second.
So what about Imola 83 then? Very emotional time for you to be in the Ferrari.
You've done your work, huh? You've done your fish.
But it emotional time, Ferrari fans all around you. I think there was even a, wasn't something written in front of your grid position on the track?
Yeah, you can
win
see.
Win for Gilles or something in yes. Italian?
Yes. You can see it on pictures.
To deliver that victory, how was it for you? How emotional?
Very, very, very emotional before the start. I am sitting in the car, going onto my slot, and I see the flag painted in front of the box where I'm supposed to stand. So I don't go there, I stay behind, for by respect for the flag and for the Italian crowd that painted that. Fair enough. And at the start, nothing particular happens. The Brabhams are off their weight because they are going into a strategy plan, which was to run softer tires and carry less fuel at the start. Suddenly, when everything is clear, only some laps remaining, get a bang on the head. No, it doesn't go that way. I have a fuel pickup problem in the Tamburello.
Yeah.
And
so you had the fuel pickup problem.
Yeah.
But then what? Suddenly it came good, and you were.
Yes, the whole rest of the lap, it's working. Everything's working normally.
Did you feel that you were winning that race for Gilles?
It's easy to say afterwards, but I had no real feeling except the one of finishing and trying to preserve the engine. Because when I got this problem, I said, oh shit, no, this is it again. I'm going to have a problem. I'm not going to finish that race. And suddenly I get hit on the head by, I don't know what, a bird. I thought such happened. Look around, going back, but very quickly, and I couldn't see anything. And I had the feeling then that I had been woken up by something extra spiritual. I am a bit mystic about things like that. And I thought that Gilles was in the car, and that's why I said I did it for Gilles also. Voilà.
It's so powerful just to hear you talk about it now. I can't even begin to imagine what it was like at the time. Which of the two victories means the most to you now? The first or the last?
The first.
The first. Hockenheim. Why?
Because it's the first.
Because it's the first. You never forget your first, right?
You never forget your first.
So how disappointed, Patrick, were you when you weren't retained by Ferrari at the end of 83? Could you feel it coming? Were you surprised?
Now, we came to the point where, what do? We have Alboreto, We have the other two. What do we do? Which one do we take? Marco, obviously, decided to go for René Arnoux. He had played the game better than me.
Politically, yes. With inside the team.
Yes.
But do you feel also that having two Frenchmen in an Italian team was unsustainable? They were definitely going to lose one of you. It wasn't a case of keeping both of you.
Forget it. wanted to keep me for development, for the car, for the time that I've spent with them. And I felt it was the right thing to do. It was fair, and yes. I mean, we had a good relationship. Mm. It was okay. And on the other hand, René had finished the season on a high, beating me. He deserved the nod also.
Mm. So three into two doesn't go?
No.
No.
Alboreto was coming in. Yeah. He had been signed since Detroit, I think.
Right. Voilà. Actually, there's one other race I wanted to ask you about when you were at Ferrari. In Monza 82... when Mario Andretti was parachuted into the team, he puts it on pole. Everyone goes mad. You actually beat him in the race, though, didn't you? But how was it being Mario's teammate? And what are your memories of that slightly mad weekend?
It was like Disneyland. It was a total different atmosphere. It was American way of being, racing.
Mm. Did it remind you of being in Can-Am?
Yes. It was Mario Andretti, fair enough. But I mean, I had a problem with my shoulder and I had to take an injection of Novocaine to stop the problem. And I drove that race with one arm, pretty much. And I finished second to René Arnoux, which on the Renault, there were three Ferrari drivers on the podium. So that's why he was very pleased with him.
Yeah.
And
how was Mario to work with?
I don't remember. I think he was very professional. But I think he was just for the check and the holiday in Italy. He was like a Messi coming to the... Yeah. Back to the... It was... very important, I think, for the team. And that's why I took it positively. But I also went for it because I didn't want to be beaten by the old guy. But
what was he? He was 41 or something at the time, wasn't he?
Not 70.
And so just quickly about the Renault years then, 84, 85. So you leave Ferrari, go to Renault. What state was the team in? You've told us already that the gearbox was no good, but do you feel that Renault had slightly fallen out of love with Formula One at that point?
No.
Still completely committed. How good was that car then in 84?
I think with Prost with me, I think we would have won the championship.
You would have won the championship with Prost in 84, yes. In a Renault?
Yes, because if you remember, I had many, many problems with the fuel. Fuel, cables, while leading the race.
Yeah.
In Dijon, brakes. In Monza, brakes of the throttle grip cable. In Sao Paulo, in Rio, fuel. Calami, fuel. Monza, Zandvoort, fuel.
Yes, it's got a comprehensive list, isn't it?
Yes, and it was crazy ruling where you had to put the fuel in the freezer to get more.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, the TAG McLaren Porsche engine had the Debye electronic, right? Mm-hmm. Debye Metre electronic.
Yeah.
We only had the mechanic.
Sure.
The nuts. You're
miles behind, yeah.
But the power was there.
The power was there, yeah. So you were, but then 85 was...
85 was the end of the... 85 was the end of the... The race for Renault at the time. Because they had bad drivers.
They didn't have bad drivers?
No, I know, but everybody fought. So.
That's how they blamed you and Derek Warwick.
I don't know what it is. I don't care.
Yeah. Well, Patrick, it was a hell of a ride, you might say, your Formula One career. How do you reflect on it all when you look at everything that happened, you know, the two wins, the five poles, the 11 podiums, 114 races?
And the Can-Am wins.
Of course, the Can-Am wins. I was just talking about two Can-Am championships, of course.
And the rest. And all the rest. Because after I finished with Formula One, I was allowed to go and break myself doing two Arikana snowmobile with off in the.
In what the did that involve?
It was with the Ronnie Medge. He was organizing.
Where were you doing the racing?
In Canada.
Really?
Quebec, all the north.
How fast are those snowmobiles?
120. Fast.
120
kilometers an hour.
Wow.
Fast. Faster than, because they were all the
why
design.
Did you do that? Why did you feel
because
the
I
need
wanted to do all the things that I didn't have the time to do or the authorization to do.
So you did snowmobile. Did you win anything? Forgive me,
no.
I don't know.
I came in first European, because all the other guys were teams of three, and
first European,
and the following year. We did it with three European. The other two were Cyril Neveu, and I think, and Hubert Auriol. So that was with three psycho.
Now look, talking of three madmen, what about the Tour de Corse jet ski race?
Jet ski race.
What was that about?
That was good.
So what, from the mainland to Corsica?
That was the... How do you say? Prologue. And then afterwards, we had to, every day, a different stage around the Tour de Corse. I had my boat. The only one of these mistakes I did. And everybody slept on board. And we had
big party. Yeah.
And that was good fun.
But what about the F1 career, Patrick? How do you reflect on it, or do you feel that you got the most out of it? Do you feel that
I should have materialized and concretized the potential. I think I had more,
because you made some wrong decisions. For example, going to McLaren instead of Ferrari in 78. Do you think it would have all been very different?
Sure.
Had you gone?
Sure, but it would not have been as diversified, but it would have been better, probably.
Did you enjoy it, though? Did you enjoy all of those races? Do you look back on Formula One with pleasure, what you achieved?
My Ferrari years, yes, for sure. That's why. Even so, it was not with my friend. We were not going together at it. It would have been good, like Villeneuve and Gilles and Arnoux in Dijon. And I think at the time now, I would have liked, I think often I'm thinking about that, I would have liked to go like Gilles and Ayrton and Hatzenberger and Ronnie and not be like I am now, sick, uncomfortable. Okay, I had good fun with you today. I opened up my book of memories that are not supposed to be released. Oh, well, they will be with the book. I hope to be finished. I think it will be finished by Christmas.
Do you feel that the list of names you've just given me...
Patrick Depailler also.
You lost a lot of friends. You lost a lot of friends.
Just too many. Too many, but maybe today... I'm not going to say it would be good for the guys out there to understand that and to be a little careful, more careful with themselves. And it's a bit silly to say that this way, but to take care of one another, to respect a little bit more one another. Mm. I think some of the guys, yes, are concerned about that. But this is a very, very dangerous sport. And they think that they are immortal in their cellule.
Well, safety's come on a lot since your day. I mean, I think you could argue, couldn't you, that your years were very dangerous, weren't they? Mm-hmm. Just look at the record. But who was the best driver you think you raced in Formula One?
I think it is Ayrton.
Oh, Ayrton, yes, of course you did, yeah.
I didn't race against Gilles, or very few races where I had some equipment. Ayrton, I had a better car. It was difficult races, the wet and Israel, for example, finishing third, survival. I take that one for
what did you say
good
to,
memory.
What did you say to Ayrton on the podium at Estoril in 85? Can you remember?
No.
Were you friendly with him?
Yeah, very friendly. I remember the year before when he had a Tolman, and the guy went and checked front left, front right, rear left, rear right. He wanted to know what all the guys in front had put on for the race in terms of chassis handling and tire wear and stuff like that.
His attention to detail impressed you.
Yes. Mm. In the crew, one of the examples also I use sometimes, that he sent me a Christmas card with a photo of his car and his helmet in the car and the photo of my car, not his car, saying it would be nice to be teammates next year. That's how tricky he was finding himself.
Do you still have that Christmas card?
I wish. Mm. I think I probably do, but I don't know where.
Mm. Well, Patrick, you're a superstar. Thank you so much for your time.
I'm just a bloke that is happy to be back and finding that he has not forgotten by you, because I didn't know you.
It's been a pleasure to meet you.
And thank you.
What an amazing man. It certainly took some effort from Patrick to chat, but his stories were great. His tale of Brazil 1978, when he kept crashing his McLaren thanks to the influence of James Hunt and a local lady friend, was gold dust. Then there was the intricate detail in which he described the key moments of his career and his friendship with Gilles Villeneuve in particular that left me with goosebumps. Thank you, Patrick, for your time. It was wonderful to chat, and I wish you all of the courage in the world as you take on your latest battle with Parkinson's disease. Well, that's it for this episode, but we'll be back next week with another fascinating guest from the world of F1. While you're waiting for that to drop, head over to your favorite podcast app and leave us a review. And while you're at it, why not click subscribe? You know it makes sense. Thank you for your kind messages about last week's show with Jody Schechter as well. Jody's a living legend, something that wasn't lost on many of you, including James Rogers. I love how Jody goes from being a stoic and serious Clint Eastwood type when talking about F1, says James, and he suddenly becomes Tom Cruise jumping on the couch talking about soil. Yep, there's no doubt that Jody's a very passionate farmer. Thanks for getting in touch, James, and please keep your feedback coming. We really love it. Remember to use the hashtag F1BeyondTheGrid, and you can tweet me at TomClarksonF1. Beyond the Grid is produced by F1 in association with Audioboom. Until next time, keep it flat out.